also invite Dr. Rohit Shetty, who is one of the instructors also on dais, please. So the basic core idea about this course is that once the residency is over, now there are so many pathways that one can take. And we are extremely happy that we have some of the best known names in ophthalmology who have gone through some of these pathways themselves, or they've created some of these pathways, and they would be telling about what they've learned during their journey, and that I'm sure would be inspiring. Now, Dr. Krishna Prasad is held up somewhere in the other course. So we'll start with Dr. Devendra Venkatramani. He's going to talk about nuts and bolts of FRCS. Devendra boasts of a great pedigree. He was a DNB student at Shankar Netralaya, and then he did his retina fellowship at L.V. Prasad Eye Institute. Currently, he's the executive director at Lakshmi Eye Institute, Panvel, Mumbai. Can you load Dr. Devendra's presentation, the second talk?
Hello. A very good morning to everybody, and it's a pleasure to be here and speaking on one of my favorite topics, that is the FRCS examinations. I'll just take you through a brief overview about the examinations and probably some of the practical aspects for anybody who is appearing or planning to appear for them. So at the outset, can we know with a show of hands how many are in the process of appearing or planning to appear for the FRCS examinations? Lovely, okay. So as you may know, there are three main Royal Colleges in the United Kingdom, and the Royal College of Surgeons of Edinburgh, Glasgow, and the Royal College of Ophthalmologists based in London, which is the most recent and yet the most powerful. And as you can see from the dates of their establishment, they have a very hoary history behind them. I'll be mainly focusing on the Glasgow examinations because that is the most accessible unless you take the ICO route, which we'll talk about a little later. So it is one of the oldest colleges, and those are some of the pictures taken from Glasgow during my visit there for the convocation ceremony. And as you can see, the convocation is held with a lot of pomp and show and pageantry, and you can see that it's a lovely experience to finish the examinations and go and treat yourself to a nice holiday in Glasgow. So the examination itself is divided into three parts. Part one is the basic sciences and optics part, which is essentially an MCQ test. Part two is based on clinical sciences. Once again, part two is divided into two sub-parts, the MCQ test and the written paper. And the written paper consists of it's a two-hour examination with four questions, three of which are on ophthalmology. And the last one, which also you have to compulsorily pass in, is on general medicine, essentially medical emergencies. The third part, they call it, it's divided into two parts called the structured oral examination, which is nothing but the vivas, and the clinical examination. They're conducted on different days. So essentially, they're almost like two separate examinations. And we'll talk about them in a little detail. So how are you eligible for these examinations? For the first part, you need to have completed your internship. Essentially, anybody who has finished their MBBS with internship is eligible. You don't need to be in an ophthalmology training to give part one. But part two, however, is you're eligible only if you've completed 5 years of post-qualification training. That means inclusive of your internship. Post-MBBS examination, if you've done 5 years, you can appear for part two. And part three, of course, you are eligible only if you've completed parts one and two successfully. The fees, these are actually a little dated. These are last year's fees. But as you can see, they really do add up to a lot. We're lucky with the devaluation of the pound. It may be a little cheaper for us to give the examinations. But as you can see, it is definitely a big cause of concern, and something that you should be mentally prepared for before you enter the course. You know, you should realize that it's going to cost you in lakhs to clear the examinations and not get disillusioned halfway through and drop out. There are a maximum of 6 attempts for each part, but as I said, even attempts you have to pay for. So I think before you reach your 6th attempt, you would be quite old and infirm, and you may just decide to drop out. All of this information is available on the college website, and I would urge you to go through it in great detail, and everything's updated fairly frequently, so you won't have any problems with outdated information there. Now, the Edinburgh examination used to be a 3-part examination, but it's now being completely overhauled, and the Royal College of Edinburgh is not conducting these examinations anymore. They're in partnership with the ICO, and there is still some clarity to be given out as to how these examinations will be conducted. This is, again, from the website. So essentially, if you've completed the ICO examinations, you are eligible to obtain the MRCS and then subsequently the FRCS degrees from the Royal College of Edinburgh. So you could take advantage of that if anybody has done the ICO examinations. That's the Royal College of Surgeons of Edinburgh website, and you would get all the information there. What I'd like to talk about a little bit about is the wonderful technique of the examining candidates. There's something called the modified Angoff technique, which essentially means that the examination papers are graded, or the students are graded on taking into account how difficult the examination is. In essence, if the examination is thought to be fairly easy by the people who set the paper, then the pass mark is set at a higher level. And conversely, if it's a difficult paper, the pass mark is at a lower level. So it's essentially a very fair examination, and that's what we appreciate when we come from a background in India where examinations could be either extremely difficult and or they could be extremely easy. So this is something that really levels the playing field as such. With regard to preparing for the examination, a few practical points. These are the textbooks I studied, I read, so I would urge everybody to use them. For clinical optics, Elkington is an excellent book, and it's very concept-based, so you could definitely bank on that. And of course, the textbook by Dr. A.K. Khurana is also excellent for optics and refraction. For the basic sciences MCQs, John Ferris, the MCQ guide is wonderful, and it has lovely detailed explanations about why a particular answer is right and why the other answers are wrong. So I would strongly urge everybody to read this book as well. And if you want to go a little more in depth in basic sciences, the textbook by John Forrester is also excellent. Incidentally, John Forrester received his honorary FRCS in the same convocation from the Glasgow College when I was attending. For part two, the MCQ aspect could be very well covered if you read this Massachusetts Eye and Ear Infirmary Review Manual for Ophthalmology by Jeffrey Lamkin and other authors. But essentially, you need to know your MS and DNB syllabus very well, because that is what is everything is based on. Emergency medicines should be handled through this book, the Oxford Handbook of Clinical Medicine, and these are the essential situations, again taken from the website. So you would have to deal with all the diagnosis and management of these emergency situations. A few tips. I would strongly urge, especially in the second and the third parts, that the candidate is practical, because it's not that theory is tested even in theory examinations. It's always a methodical approach that gets you the points. You have to approach the answer in a particular logical manner. You are generally given case situations or clinical scenarios. For example, a patient with watering eyes, and how would you, what would be your line of thought? It's not list the causes of epiphora, in order of frequency. So, additionally, one should proceed from a life-threatening condition to something that's vision-threatening, and the least would be something of cosmetic interest. So if you follow a logical approach, you're sure to do well. With regard to the viva, it's 3 tables of 20 minutes each, and they've overhauled it, so now it is very ophthalmology-based, but you do have a viva in which you have a physician sitting along with the ophthalmologist. That's the general medicine and neurology viva, and you will be asked questions on general medicine pertaining to ophthalmology, or medical emergencies once again would be touched upon in that viva. Most of the viva proceeds in a logical manner from easy to difficult sub-questions. I'll take a few, maybe a minute more. And the viva is essentially over in an hour before you realize it. So it's really quite a whirlwind, as is the clinical examination. The clinical examination is divided into four stations: anterior segment, posterior segment, neuro-ophthalmology and ocular motility disorders, and oculoplastic and lid disorders. So as you can see, everything is covered. And unlike Indian examinations, where we had the luxury of leaving neuro-ophthalmology for option, you really can't do any such thing. If you don't know basic neuro-ophthalmology and squint or basic oculoplasty, you will not clear the examination.
Yeah, great. Thank you, then.
That's it. It's 12 minutes per station. And of course, the more patients, the more number of patients you see, the better it is, because it indicates to the examiners that you're doing well. Practice does pay, so I would strongly urge everybody giving the examination to practice with mock patients or with a partner. That's what I did. Dr. Asif Virani was a very good friend, and we became close during the examination. So having a study buddy is excellent for this. Few advantages. Some tangible benefits are, essentially, you are exempt from giving the PLAB if you are applying for positions in the UK. You do get better remuneration offered if you are applying for positions in the Middle East. And in certain cases, it's accepted as a valid degree in ophthalmology. However, these things do change with time, so I would strongly urge you to look at the local guidelines before banking on these degrees for job placements. Yeah. So I'd just like to say that in the end, it's all about the sense of achievement that you get from giving examinations. One need not go to this extent. As I like to put up this slide, you don't have to really become so obsessed about degrees, but it does give you a wonderful sense of achievement having cleared the examination. So I'd just like to end by introducing our FRCS refresher course that we conduct at Panvel every year. We are now in our fifth year, and these are some scenes where we have hands-on training for candidates with real patients, so you get a real feel of the vivas as well as the clinical examinations. You could take a screenshot of that for further details. It's generally in the month of August that we conduct this. Thank you so much for your patient hearing and for the opportunity.
If fortunate, because we have actually examiners from Royal College of Surgeons and Physicians, Glasgow, which is Dr. Rohit Shetty, and also the examiner for the Royal College of Surgeons, Edinburgh, Dr. Meenakshi. I see Dr. Kasturi, who is also an examiner for the Glasgow College. So may I ask Rohit to maybe give your perspective as an examiner?
I think most of it he'd already explained, but being an examiner, I realized one thing. It's about, so a lot of you are picking up many wrong way of looking at exams techniques from books which are not validated. For example, this time was a very bad result. I think more than 50 or 60% of them failed in practicals. The reason is the RAPD test, which is classically how you do. For some reason, somebody has read the same book which says this way. You know? And the examiner said, the swinging is so slow, by the time you reach the other side, the consensual is active. And all of them missed the RAPD in that eye. And I had nothing else to say. One guy had a big beard. So he was so careful to avoid his beard, he was going all the way down and like this. And by the time he went there, there was no thing. So it's because when it was asked, the people said that it was written in the book that you have to have a swinging fast light and you're following it. And be very careful about what techniques you follow. There's only 7 or 8 places which you have to be very good at, and you'll pass exams. So you will have an RAPD, and nobody. And here it's all about that. It's not about diagnosing an RAPD, about asking the people whether you have on, off the lights, on the light.
Yes, absolutely.
And there's two candidates today. It's very interesting to being an examiner, because you know why people are failing. Two candidates failed because they made the patient sit on a slit lamp and you did not bother to off the light. And the light was on the patient's forehead. And the patient was making gestures saying that it's light is hurting, the candidate did not bother to off it.
Absolutely. In fact, there has been anecdotal story which goes around in Edinburgh that you have to make sure that you make your patients very comfortable. So the story goes like this, that there was a candidate who was not doing so well, and he suddenly realized that the patient is not comfortable. So he offered a cup of coffee to the patient and he actually passed that station. Of course, that does not mean that you keep offering coffee whenever you're not doing well, but what your point is that you have to make sure that patient's comfort comes is very important.
And to sum up this, after every candidate goes out, there are two examiners, and always remember that the examiner is asking the question is not the always the one who marks you the marks. The other examiner who's not asking you a question is the one who's marking you. So one examiner's focus is only on questions, the other examiner's focus is only on marking you. So it's a very structured organization, so you be very, very easy. It's probably the easiest examination to pass if we just assume that, you know, this is all you need to do. I think it's easier than your postgraduate exams. Yeah. But only thing we are making mistakes is picking up the wrong techniques, wrong use of videos. I think you have to be very careful about it. Simple swinging flashlight, if it's not done properly, you're going to fail.
Thank you, Rohit. And let me introduce you about your topic. Rohit is going to talk on ophthalmic research and basic science, and I cannot think of anybody better at the moment who can do justice to this topic. He has been instrumental in starting this clinical scientist concept in India, and he already has three PhDs under his mentorship who are going to get the PhD or already got the PhD. And he has lots of ideas, and the best part about him is that his clinical lab, where he has employed mathematician to technologists to engineers, and it's open for all. Anybody who has a good idea can go to him, say, this is what I want to work on, and if it suits his policy, then he'll let you work on it. Rohit.
Thank you, sir. And my talk is on ophthalmic research and the way forward. These are my financial interests. The first question which everybody asks is, why research? Is research something to do, present a paper, or just come to AIOS or one of the meetings? So the way I look at research is asking questions. They say that everybody saw apples fall, only Newton asked why. That basically that question, what you keep asking. The two things which runs in your mind, the angel in your genes, which wants you to do something good, keeps asking you, can I? But there are a lot of these demons, which is also playing a role, keeps asking you why. What are you going to do? I mean, we are not going to get better just by publishing few papers. What really takes you to the next level? It's exactly the same question he asked. Why do you need an Frcs? It's not going to help us really in our promotions, or I don't think any hospitals give you extra money for having a degree. But it's like asking somebody who's a marathon runner, why do you want to run? Or why do you want to exercise at 3 o'clock in the morning? There's something different driven in these people, because you want to run a marathon or 40 kilometer, because there must be something driving you, something making you feel good. That feel good is what you have to fight the demons for, because that's what plays a very important role. And we start seeing things very differently. But a biggest disclaimer is when you start is everything looks crazy when you start. And you're going to have a lot of people coming and asking you that this path is not the right way. But there's somewhere you have to start. I run this at 1% rule. If you make 1% change a day, you'll reach somewhere. So Dr.Rashmin has already mentioned, the first thing when we started is, you start talking to people who are not your own. If you speak to the same group here, you may have an oculoplasty surgeon, a retina surgeon, but we are all ophthalmologists. You'll not learn much other than just the ophthalmology part of it. When you start mingling with people who are non-ophthalmologists, you start becoming better. That's when you have a bunch of people out there with whom you start working with. And I'm just giving you a genesis of our way of we worked. So we build our own team. We have close to around 100 scientists today of different range from immunology A to Z, AI to people who work on zebrafish genetics. So I call it like an Amazon. And these are the group of people with whom I work. And this took close to 15 to 17 years to build. We had to handpick them. This is what scares a lot of my fellows the first day when they join. You don't write the OT notes, but you collect every single sample which you normally discard. This is epithelium, this is your smile lenticules, this is the tears, Schirmer strips, this is something else, This is maybe a lash from an oculoplasty. Everything gets collected, everything gets stored, everything gets signed by the patient. Because without even, this is what you discard, but ethics is most important in research. So this again gets into patient, there may be one in 1,000 patient who says, I don't want my Schirmer strip to be preserved, so we throw it. So this is the first induction into this research. In this AIOS, I'll just show you some of these papers by these young people like all of you who did their own work. This is, I just gave them ideas. And they'll tell you how this research would change. Completely building a novel AI. He built it himself with a group of people. He's going to be my fourth PhD clinician fellow, Dr. Gyrick. And this is how it works. A research question, can AI help in progression? Is a research question. This is Dr. Pooja's work. She found a very completely novel bacteria in keratoconus. How does it work? It works because we have no idea what drives the inflammation. And she was able to isolate the genome of a bacteria. And you can see the what it's going to do. What it's going to do is it's completely tomorrow going to find the way the bacteria is driven. Can I have 1 minute more? This is a kit. We've been talking about it, but what is interesting is now the kit is in the clinic. It ranges from psychology. This is Dr. Prerna's work, and how psychiatric patients behave differently. This is Dr. Rohan Mehra. He built a Miyake apple. There's very few Miyake apple. Miyake apple looks at the surgeries, training of surgeries in a globe eye from behind. That means from a posterior pole. David Miyake built the first apple, but you need 2 microscopes. He worked on a method using just an iPhone 11, an app-based delivery system. All this, what does it drive to? There's a huge potential among all of you to create it. And I just gave them ideas. They did everything by themselves because you have a team. So what I'm just giving an example is, you just give a fertile land, you can build anything in this country. And this is just AIOS. And none of them actually won anything. Not a single paper. But they've all been winning everywhere else because we are still in that mode where this does not. Yesterday, one judge comes to me and says that, what is the use of making all this? Where is it going to be useful? I said, the average time for somebody to get a Nobel Prize is 25 years. So that means somebody, when you start at 20, on the first year, everybody will say it's useless. But these are the paper which will change in the next 5 years. And this is where you guys are going to be there. And this is what the research is going to be. I'll just take 2 slides. It's just not fellowships today. We are also in the threshold of a change where you can actually look at PhD when people start asking this question. It's not about smooth or butter, it's about what temperature. I'll just skip all this. Fortunately, I had the fortune of guiding 2 of my first PhD clinicians in the country. This is from Maastricht. The third one is known to Dr. Rashmin. He's just got a letter yesterday, Dr. Ashwin Mohan. So I'm just giving an example of how you can change your directions. And the first thing what they said is that PhDs don't operate. So what I do is every conference I make them to do live surgeries so that people will know that you just don't do PhDs. The question when I was asked is, you are doing research because you don't know how to do surgeries. So now I don't want my youngsters to believe that they don't know to do surgeries, so they are the ones who do live surgeries in all my meetings. So basically what I'm trying to say is, there's a completely new world out there. I just don't restrict yourself to a box. And please go out, you can do everything. If this 20, 30 of them can do every year something or the other, I think you guys are much, much connected today as a group. There are a lot of fine groups today which will teach you, tell you what to do compared to what we did when we started. Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much, Rohit. Thank you. We move on to our next speaker, who is Dr. Krishna Prasad, in a very traditional attire. And he's going to talk about maximizing residency and fellowship opportunities in India. Dr. Krishna Prasad is from M.M. Joshi Eye Hospital, Hubli.
So good morning. Just an hour ago, I spoke about, you know, what exam cases you get and how to get across the exam. But when you're doing a post-graduation or a fellowship even, We always, I interact with postgraduates, they always crib about the shortcomings of their training area. Like they say, we don't have that, we don't have this equipment, we don't have teachers, we have no exposure to certain specialities. So whenever you're doing whatever, place that you're working, whatever setup you're actually getting trained, it also has some bright spots. I think you have to look at the brighter set of things and try to do the best. So I'm just going to give you some kind of an perspective of how you can maximize your opportunities for your training. So that is very important. I'll tell you, these are the best days. If you're thinking that you are really got a hard days for post-graduation, think when you come into practice, you always want the grass is always greener on the other side. You always think these are the best days where you can really set a, you know, set your course right and also have lots of fun. Simplistically, a triad of success is basically three things. Knowledge, your hardcore knowledge of ophthalmology, how much you know about eye and its problems, and the skills. So knowledge is basically cognitive, skills are basically psychomotor, that lot of skills that you need to acquire during your training. And the last one is attitude, that is something which is affective domain, that is purely yours, that nobody can really change much. You come with a baggage of attitude. The knowledge and skills is something that we can actually tamper with. What is knowledge? See, presently there is so much of information available, especially with the digital era, and the time that you have in postgraduate is too short. Many times you get admitted late, you have exams much earlier. The time that you are actually endowed with for taking the... So what is basically the idea of learning ophthalmology? Is it to pass this exam, this silly, dumb exam? No. It is the patient who sits in front of you in the clinic is your examiner. So think about that. I think that probably makes your exams also easier. Now you have so many information that you are really lost what to read. There are so many books available. They are much easier for us. Like recently, I had around 50 GB of 1,500 recent textbooks. I just chanced upon it. I gave it to my PGs in my classroom. I said, you all copy it. I thought they will be rejoiced to see so many books on all categories and all. I just forgot about it. Suddenly I realized after the next class, I asked, how many have copied? So not even one person had copied it. That means you are now, there is nothing, no, I mean, because it's available so easily for you, the information, that, okay, now there is no need to search for information. Only thing is the time is too short. But at the same time, you should understand what you should learn should be relevant and contemporary. There's no point reading the Duke Elder's old edition, How to Fit a Limbal Ring, or what are the old HIFEMA classification. They don't really hold good anyway. Okay. So basically, it has to be usable, practical, because the knowledge, that's the reason why you have to attend conferences, talk to mentors. Okay. See, many a times what happens is, you really do not know the crux of the issue. We actually fear asking questions to seniors and fellow ophthalmologists, anything about basics, because we fear that they will not know. Okay, their ignorance will be exposed. See, for example, in a recent, last time I was talking about something, gathering ophthalmologists, I came to know that nobody really knew anything about higher order aberrations. They hear so much, but nobody has really taught them, because when we become seniors, no, we can't learn basics. So our ego comes in, or we have no time, or we don't get an opportunity. This is the time where you can ask questions and you can be foolish. Okay, you have to stay hungry, stay foolish. You can afford to be foolish and ask a basic silly question, sir, what is higher order aberration? So that is where the mentor chips in. We can, any mistake that you make, please understand, the whole skill of asking a question is died down. No student asks a question. Okay. If you ask a question, you fear that people think you are a fool. Every mistake that you make in answering a question, okay, is a teaching opportunity. So make sure that you ask questions to your mentors, and that is where you learn. Skills are many. Observational skills, top one. See, when you observe, you learn. Surgical skills. See, that is very paramount for an ophthalmic surgeon, that you need to pick up your hand-eye coordination and surgical skills. Clinical and diagnostic skill. This is something very important, puts you across. When you're there in practice, your life becomes so easy, enjoyable, because of your diagnostic skills. And just recently I came from an IC of a communication where I was a chief instructor. Communication is everything for a postgraduate. Okay, the postgraduates have that foot in the mouth syndrome. They blurt out something, they tell very non-relevant things, sometimes they can't tell the prognosis, they can't break the bad news. You need to really put in your effort, because there is no curriculum for you in communication and counseling.
Nobody has taught you, there's no marks for that. So you, that is something innate that we expect you to know. So communication skills sets apart for a gratifying practice. And obviously you need to know how to write your exams and pass at the end of the day. These are observational skills. See, I found PGs who observe during my OT, like they have seen one or two cases when they are given a chance to do it, they do it. They have seen how to implant a particular eye oil, brand of eye oil. When they're given a chance, they do it because they've seen it. So make sure that your observation is everything. When you're watching, think that you're going to do this next time and watch it with all the attention. That is something very important. And just like a reverse osmosis, when some senior is seeing an OPD patient, just watch how they start, how they break the ice, how they talk, how they connect, how they get the information. Always, just like we do an OCX for you, so you actually do a reverse OCX, okay? You have to sit behind Dr. Meenakshi and see how she sees a child. So that is something that you can directly copy-paste in your thing. And this is very important. Surgical skills, everybody creeps that we don't have enough surgical cases, we don't have microscopes for it, the HOD doesn't allow us to operate. There are always ways of, you know, doing some innovation. I know a medical college where there was only one microscope. The consultant did not give it to the postgraduate fearing that it will be damaged. They had enough stipend. They had around 40,000, 50,000 stipend. They just chipped in 10,000. There were 18 of them. They chipped in 10,000. They made a 2 lakh kitty, and they got a second-hand upper semi microscope, exclusively bought by the PGs. And HOD had no answer. He had to give everything. There were cases, but there were no microscopes. And they, you know, did for 2 years, learned surgery. When they left the college, they sold the 10,000 shares to the next incoming PGs. So they got that money also back. Looking at their enthusiasm, the upper semi gave 2 more microscopes. Okay, it's basically that you can always look at the negative side, but there's always a way to get around any problem. This is something very important. Success lies in Broca's area. Please watch people, rehearse, enact, understand how you break the news, how you counsel. These are the things which will set you apart from day one as a very successful practitioner. This is something very, very important. Okay, and finally, the clinical skills, you have to spend least time and get the maximum information. And getting the quality information and accurate information. So this is something that you need, you can maximize. Whatever patient you are seeing every day, you may not have equipment, but you have patients. So learn your diagnostic skills, learn your clinical skills on your patient. So that is makes you from a novice to an expert. And finally, the attitude, that is all yours. And unless you have the right attitude, all these things may not really work. Thanks for your attention. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. KP. Thank you so much. We'll move on, and now we have Dr. Akshay Nair. He'll talk about the examinations and fellowships which you can take. Akshay, again, was a DNB at Shankar Netralaya, and then he did his oculoplasty fellowship at L.U. Prasada Institute. Currently, he's one of the leading oculoplasty surgeons in Mumbai.
Thank you. Is Dr. Claire in the audience? No. So I think Dr. Gandhi, since Dr. Claire is not there, I'll start off with the exams also.
I'm sorry?
Since Claire isn't there, I'll start with the exams.
Sure.
Okay. So show of hands, how many of y'all have taken the ICO examinations? And all parts of them, or how many are y'all planning to take at least one of them in the in this coming year or in the future? Oh, good. Okay. So there's a reasonable interest in the audience. So there will be a little bit of overlap along with what Devendra discussed in terms of how to prepare for the examination and the equation that the ICO has with the FRCS. So first, when we talk about the ICO examinations, this is different from the FRCS. This is an assessment examination, which in a way tells you that if you've cleared the ICO examinations, you're on level with your peers and are of a certain level of competence. It may increase job opportunities for you. And of course, like Devendra mentioned, you have the joy of giving an exam, which all of us for some reason have. And we love adding initials after our name. Also, the ICO examinations, by virtue of being as expensive as they are, is a good way of making sure that you actually study in residency. And now, with as Dr. Devendra mentioned, there is a reciprocity with the FRCS, the Royal College of Surgeons of Edinburgh. How does it work? If you've appeared. So essentially, from this year, the FRCS Edinburgh, as of now, is not going to be taking any more examinations because it stops at the MRCS level over here. So if you've given your ICO basics, that is equivalent, basic sciences and optics and refraction, that is equivalent to your FRCS Part A. In addition, if you've given your clinical sciences and the advanced, that would be equivalent to your FRCS Part B, and by virtue of that, you can apply for the member, to become a member of the MRCS ED. They are still in the stages of evaluating their plans ahead, so as of now, there are no FRCS Edinburgh exams that would be conducted in this next session. The ICO examinations also make you eligible to appear for the ICO, to apply for the ICO fellowships. These are 3 month, 6 month, and 1 year fellowships, and the website clearly says it is recommended that you sit for the ICO examinations before applying for fellowship. Although there is, we all of us know a couple of people who have been awarded these fellowships even without taking the exam, but at the end of the day, when there are so many people applying for that limited number of fellowships, it is better to be on par with the rest having appeared for these examinations. So you also want to see what is the benefit of doing it. Just because everybody else is in doing it, should I also do it? So you do get the opportunity to add the post-nominal FICO initials after your name. As we've said multiple times, it helps you have a little bit of more ease in navigating through the FRCS maze and possibly better job opportunities, but it is not a qualifying examination that allows you to practice in an additional country, unlike the FRCS. The ICO fellowships, like I mentioned, can technically be done even without the examinations, and at the end of the day, all of these exams cost money. So which are the different exams? I'll quickly go through. There is the visual sciences, the Part A, best to be appeared during your residency. It's 120 questions, 4 choices, multiple choice answers. These are the subjects that are covered in that. They are plain regular anatomy that you'd read in your first year along with a lot of other things. Significant amount of weightage given to genetics, epidemiology, and pharmacology. So you just can't leave that and go. The next is your Part B, optics, refraction, and instruments. Typically clubbed with Part A, you can take both together. 60 questions, 1.5 hours, multiple choice. Remember, if you take Part A and Part B together, the candidate must obtain passing marks each of these two papers separately. So, and if you do not pass any one, you can reappear for that individually, and only then can you take the Part C, which is the clinical side. Excuse me. The best time to take this is just after residency, because you've just read your Kansky or whichever reference textbook is, cover to cover, 200 MCQs, single best answer. And as you can see, most of the topics are primarily what you've already read throughout your residency. Nothing unusual in this. Finally, the advanced examination. They need you. This can be done after residency. If you're planning a fellowship, can be done during fellowship. It is called a competence and technical ability test. So it does not verify your training or your practical competence. It's just an exam to see how you know your knowledge level. These are extended type matching questions where you have 75 context setting description. They'll give you a case. They'll give you a case description, or maybe a photograph, a diagnostic investigation, and 4 associated statements which require a single best response answer. They also have started the subspecialty examination in the following specialties over here. Each of these specialties also has a cataract examination part within it. It needs 1 year's clinical experience after having trained. It's a 2-hour exam, and again, 80 contextual setting descriptions, which are case-based questions. A single best response is to be given. The fees, yes, if you start from the visual sciences, optics, refraction, clinical, advanced, and subspecialty, you will pay 1,73,000 as per January's exchange rates, which is quite a bit of a amount. But of course, you stagger it so it doesn't hit you all at once. How do you prepare? This is where, you know, most of it is what Dr. Devendra already mentioned. The basic sciences, the essential reading for that is Elkington, Clinical Optics, which is in its third edition. Dr. Khurana's textbook of Optics and Refraction is also an equally good book. John Frcs and John Forrester are recommended reading as per the ICO curriculum itself. So before the examinations, you should read. From anecdotal experience and from our own, from what we've heard from people who've taken the exam and also what we've noticed, a lot of MCQs from Frcs tend to come verbatim as is in the textbook, in the paper, which helps a lot of us Indians who are so used to reading by rote and learning it by heart. So, you know, we are also able to pick up, oh, this is exactly the wordings that is worth. So that may be of an advantage to read that book well. Lamkin, the Massachusetts Iron Year Infirmary that was discussed earlier, is again a great book to read for clinical sciences. Kansky, this is how it looked when we took the examination. This is how it is now, and it's also undergone a name change, and now it's back to Kansky. Then I come to ICO examinations. There are different types of ICO fellowships. They have the three-month, the retinoblastoma fellowships. They have subspecialty fellowships dedicated to uveitis, glaucoma, and ocular oncology. These are for 3 to 6 months. They have a one-year retina research fellowship also, as well as the Fred Hollows one-year research fellowship. Ocular genetics and the Allergan partnership fellowship are for 1 year, but they are only in the area of basic sciences and ophthalmic genetics. I'm going to focus primarily on the three-month fellowship because these are the ones that the ICO awards widely. There are almost 90 to 100 such fellowships awarded each year. The stipend or the scholarship that is given to you is almost $6,000. You need to have completed your entire training as an ophthalmologist to be eligible to even apply for the fellowship. If you're still in training, you cannot apply. So you have to finish your residency and only then apply. You could be in your fellowship or having completed your fellowship. There's an age cap, 40 years. And you also have to give an assurance in writing that you will return to your home country after your fellowship. The application process is extremely transparent. The website is icoph.org, the ICO International Council of Ophthalmology. And in the how to apply section, they have it in very clear steps. Select the fellowship that you want to look for, a three-month or a six-month. Complete the eligibility check. The eligibility check is basically where you upload your documents confirming that you are a trained ophthalmologist, you hold your qualifications and are fit to practice in your country, along with a few other supporting documents that they ask, like your proof of age and identity, etc. In a turnaround of 24 to 48 hours, they get back to you telling that you are eligible for a fellowship and now you can proceed. Once the eligibility review is done, they have a directory where you can choose the host that you want to. You can look up which area of specialty you have, you are interested in, or if there's a particular person with whom you want to be trained in, you can look that person's institute and directly apply through the ICO website itself. You do not need to write to them individually if they're already in the directory. The matching is done by the ICO. They receive your application, and depending on your application status as well as your credentials, they will accept or decline, and then you get a note saying whether it's been accepted or not. It's fairly transparent, takes about 2 to 3 months, and then you get your reply. However, if this entire process, once after your first application is rejected, the ICO has a very clear policy that you cannot apply for any fellowship, for any three-month fellowship again. You can apply for a different duration of fellowship. Sometimes you may have a particular interest in a fledgling subspecialty or a particular research project, and that institute where that cutting edge technology is available or that area of research is being done is not in your host directory. As was the case that happened to me, and I wrote to ICO, they said that there are these cases, this is a screenshot of the email that they wrote back to me, that you can actually write to them and explain your situation. If they do accept an observership or a fellowship for 3 months, give us that invitation letter and we'd be happy to consider it.
Akshay, last minute.
Yeah, this is just wrapping it up. Couple of things that you need to think of is when to do your ICO fellowship. I advise, strongly advise, that doing a fellowship in India is better than, is before your ICO fellowship is better. You already have a reasonable amount of competence and surgical skill, such that even by mere observation, you are able to know whether you can duplicate this back when you go, as opposed to a resident who is relatively fresh and may not be able to apply that into their clinical practice. Don't think of it as just any other vacation. And 3 months is optimal, but at the end of the day, you have to ask yourself what, these are not just questions I want you to ask yourself, these are actual questions that are there in the ICO application form. So you need to come up with solid answers that work with the ICO and convey that you are interested in it and that you're going to come back and practice in your host country. I'll skip through this. I had a 3-month stint at the New York Eye and Ear Infirmary in Ocular Oncology. We were able to publish a lot during that time. Yeah, so finally, at the end of the day, you have to plan well. If you apply for a 3-month fellowship in 2019, when the application date is ending in March, the chances are you would get a 3-month slot somewhere in the middle of 2021. So it doesn't fit as per your planned calendar. You'll have to plan things according to that. So take into consideration the decision of your inputs of everybody, your family, your employers, because they also have a stake in your career. Chart a timeline. At the end of the day, the ICO examinations and the fellowships are an asset that can help build your practice, add to your skills, and improve the quality of your practice. If you have any queries, I'd be happy to reply to you personally on email in case we do run out of time for Q&A at the end of this session.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Akshay. I'll now invite Dr. Meenakshi Swaminathan. And her topic is a little broad topic of ready to take the plunge. I'd also request her, since she's the examiner with the Royal College of Surgeons, Edinburgh, to also give a latest news about the Frcs ICO conundrum.
Thank you, Rashmin, and thank you for inviting me to be a part of this instruction course. So the Frcs Edinburgh, yes, has undergone a lot of change. It is trying to become a friendly exam. So, as earlier speakers have alluded to, if you have passed your ICO advanced, then you automatically qualify to get the MR, to apply for the membership of the Royal College. You just have to apply, that's all. But if you want the FRCS, there is one other step, which will be the Part C exam, as it used to be called, which is going to be held for the first time. It's a brand new exam, and it's going to be held for the first time in India in May of this year. There is not going to be a practical component. Well, for the first exam for validation, we are going to have a few patients. Otherwise, it's going to be only a structured orals. But it is going to be all specialties in great depth, as if you have a patient in front of you. So that, and after that, once you've passed that, then you're going to be eligible for the fellowship of the Royal College of Edinburgh. So it is potentially going to be a very friendly exam. So I encourage you all to take it. All right, ready to take the plunge. So this topic, I thought about, what do you say? I mean, is it going to feel, applying for fellowship, is it going to feel like jumping off a cliff? It's not as bad. Can be close. How many of you here after residency think you're going to apply for a fellowship? Show of hands. Quite a few. So I am coming to you today from experience of having sat on a selection panel for fellowships at Shankar Netralaya for about 14 years. So I'm going to give you an inside look at what, as an interviewer, you look for and what puts you off, so that you know how to be prepared whether you are applying. And I also sat on the panel for selecting consultants for a job in SN as well. We also, Rashmin and I, used to select DNB residents and DO residents before it became a centralized process. So I'll give you an insider's look so that you're better prepared next time. So first of all, when you apply, you are asked to send your CV, correct? So that is where you make a mark. So you must impress the person who is going to employ you or select you for fellowship, but with some humility and honesty. So what are the things to avoid? So I call this a super duffer CV because it starts off by saying, I am a hard worker, working, committed, eager to learn, willing to work longer. Yeah, right, right. Yeah, we believe you. No, no, don't do all these general statements on your CV. Let it be professional. Please also don't start your career with nursery school. 89 to 92, I was a star nursery school, and then I was in senior second. No, we hope you finished the school before you finished your MBBS. And look at that bottom line. Sometimes the whole CV is written in that font. It looks very stylish, but you know, I'm having a hard time reading it. Also, it's great that you attended all these conferences, but please don't list them out. Maybe you had a jolly good program, a sweet program director who said, chalo beta, go, you can attend everything you want to attend. And then you said, I attended IRSEC, ASOSD, NOA, whatever, you know. No, please don't. Reference to, and if you're going to submit a reference, you submit it, you put, and if you have submitted a publication or a published work and you're going to put it in your CV, let it be in the proper AMA style, okay? Let it not be whatever you please. And sometimes I've seen people put, leaving out the chief author's name. I said, what, you wrote alone in the exam, in your PG, is it? You didn't have a mentor? Then say, yes, madam, sorry, I forgot to put. So don't cut a sorry figure. So if reading books is listed as a hobby, which seems to be a common thing, hobby in the last will be reading books and listening to music. You better know some books, okay? Because I, for a point, will always ask. So we had a fellowship applicant who said bird watching. And not that type of birds, but the ones with wings. But his bad luck, I'm a bird watcher. I said, where are you bird watcher? Jamnagar, okay? Tell me, what are the waders you have seen in Kichadia? Luckily for him, he knew the waders. So he got selected. So you be careful when what you put as your hobbies. And then they will ask you for professional references. Your uncle, father's friend uncle, neighbor uncle, somebody who saw you from when you were in diapers, father's golf partner. These are all not professional references. Sometimes you ask them who this person is, they'll say, he's my neighbor. When did you last go to his clinic? He'll say, but he's a doctor of literature. He doesn't even have a clinic. So please don't do that. Have an explanation for long gaps in the CV. It's good. If you ask people, what were you doing in the last 2 years? I see a gap in your CV. They'll say, I was preparing for NEET. Okay. What else? Preparing for NEET cannot be your only activity. So make sure that you have done some observership or you have attended, taken on online course. Online course may be something in how to do practice management. It doesn't matter. But you were actively learning. You were actively doing something towards your career should be reflected in your CV. And definitely avoid fancy emails. I once had a candidate whose email said cycloplegia@gmail.com. Clearly, he was trying to impress. But we ragged him so much that he went out and then he changed it.
I think it showed his commitment to ophthalmology at that time. I think it showed his commitment to ophthalmology.
Yeah, shows his commitment to ophthalmology. He's trying to defend himself.
We all know who that trainee was now.
So I'm going to be modest, and I'm going to just share with you what I think a standard CV should look like, okay? So if you see, it even says sex female. Meenakshi, generally in India, we know it's a female. But when you apply for fellowships abroad, they have no idea for a Meenakshi Swaminathan. They don't know where it starts and where it ends. So you make sure that you have your CV is kind of standard. Now let me go down it if I can get this to work. Isko niche kaise le jana hai? What are you doing? Ha, super. So if you go up a little bit, thoda upar le jaiye. If you go up a little bit. So it starts off with, go up some more. Up. So if you see my address is there, medical qualification, go down. Clinical appointments, go down. Or thoda sa. All through the years, absolutely with no gaps, go up some more. Or. Appointments in education, then you have the whole thing coming year-wise. Okay, in fact, if you see my CV, it says April 2019. Even that is a bad thing. You don't want a CV that is not updated. We are already in February 2020. Your CV should be really up to date. Go down, or thoda sa. And some more. Little bit more. And of course, if you're a reviewer, if you've won awards, if you're a member of society, if you have your publications, all this should be reflected in your CV. Okay? And in a methodical, systematic manner. do some homework and preparation before you go for the interview. Make sure you have spent some time observing specialists in your specialty of interest. I have people applying for pediatric ophthalmology and squint fellowship, and you say, why are you interested? They'll say, I never saw any squint in my PG. Hare, how do you know you even like it? Okay, you come and then you ruin my happiness as well. Usko thoda band kariye. Right. Even if you worked with dad or mom, make sure you really worked and not just say so in the CV. I've had people who say, I spent time in my dad's practice. And then so if you ask him, tell me what are the types of patients you saw? Tell me, what did you do? Did you actually take vision? Did you do refraction? Did you do IOP? Blank. So you know, he probably went and sat there and looked at his Facebook account. So make sure you attend relevant sessions in the conferences so that you know whether really this is your subspecialty choice. Is this your calling? Maybe do a formal observership. Write to institutes. Many of them encourage observerships. You can go for 5 days, 1 week, couple of days, club it with another conference that you're going to attend anyway, and then get an insider's look at really how the specialty is, how the fellows are. You get a chance to talk to the previous fellows, the current fellows, and so you are completely prepared whether this is the thing you want to do. You also need to know the following. What are the facilities, faculty of the department wherein you're applying? What are their publications and research interests? And try and sneak in and attend sessions in the conferences where they are giving keynote or where they're talking. See if this is the person you want to learn from. Do you want this person to be your teacher? So why cornea? If I ask, there will be people who will say, my grand uncle had a white cornea when I was growing up. You know, it's nice. It sounds nice in a story, fiction, okay? Let's have something a little more concrete. I had a fellowship applicant who clearly said, ma'am, I want to do oculoplasty because in this city in Andhra Pradesh, there are no oculoplastic surgeons. I think I have a good market. Hey, good plan. Nothing wrong with that, okay? Money is not a bad thing. So also know the latest developments, but more importantly, really know the basics well. Don't say, I'm passionate about cornea, and then you're shown a PBK and you're just staring at it, okay, wondering what is this. Because a lot of the fellowships will have a written component, which is MCQs, and then will usually have a viva. We'll have actual cases being presented to you on laptops, and we'll ask you to discuss. So you better be prepared. Nothing obscure, but you better be prepared with your basic knowledge that is expected of you. Few more minutes, Rashmin.
Yeah.
The D-Day, okay, it's here. Arrive early, don't look hassled. You've been searching for the last half an hour, the Ola didn't come or whatever, don't look hassled, okay? Arrive, check the place the day before. I would encourage you to go, arrive the day before, go and find out what is the way to get to that. You're coming from Chandigarh to Chennai, okay? It's easy to get lost. The auto fellow will cheat you, I'm telling you. Let us not dissuade you from applying to SN. Please apply to SN. So make sure you carry water bottle, sandwich, a bar of chocolate. You never know how the day is going to go. Okay? Make sure you have a nourishment. Don't come like this. We notice everything. Remember, we are ophthalmologists. We are impressed with images. So we notice everything. Bad nails, pink nails, uncut nails, scratched nails, bitten nails. Please. I mean, Keanu Reeves is handsome and all that. But no. That looks shabby. Look at that. Okay, because I'm sitting down and looking, sizing you up as you're talking, and I'm seeing those unpolished shoes. So you can't take care of yourself. How are you going to take care of my patient? You know, you look really good in those clothes, but maybe not for an interview. And, you know, no heels and make duck, 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 duck sound. It's disturbing. You're interviewing and somebody is doing duck, duck, duck outside. Doesn't go well. This is really annoying. Okay, and then you have people who will be shaking their legs. I'm sure you know those as well. So a poise is so important in how you come across in an interview. Please no mobile phones, okay? Please don't let them ring. And then as soon as you come out, don't go and befriend your interviewer on social media. Okay, I knew I was dealing with a different generation because on day one of the PG orientation, I go home, my first year PG has sent me a friend request. So I knew I was leading with a different generation, but still, you know, examiners, fellowship, mentors tend to be a little old-fashioned. So, you know, they tend to have some grace. So please respect that. And don't come in a white coat. I've actually had people come in a white coat with a stethoscope. I'm like, I hope you're a doctor. We know you're you have basic MBBS. You don't have to prove wearing a white coat. Smart casuals are okay. These days we are okay with smart casuals. But look at that. That is an overdressed dude. Look at him. Okay, and look at this guy, he's got jeans on. I've had people who come to the interview with jeans, shirt outside, sleeves rolled up, they're like they're going to work in the garden. Okay? So all these things matter. Let me tell you, your subject, I know if you come with a very bright idea, but very shabby looking to Rohit Shetty, I don't know if he's going to take you. But still, let us be conservative. Let us, you know, follow certain basic norms. So that is all I have to you as to how to present yourself in an interview. But you're welcome to attend our Cataract Catalyst, 6th and 7th June, and Intraocular Tumor Conference, 9th and 11th July, and EVOKE. Any optometrist you know, please, this is the ESO's International Vision Science and Optometry Conference covering a wide variety of subjects, which is happening in August. So we are very happy to invite all of you. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you, Dr. Meenakshi. I just wanted to know if Dr. Dalal Shoki is here, because the scientific committee wanted him to deliver a keynote address as part of this session. Is Dr. Dalal Shoki here? If not, then we have around 12, 13 minutes for discussion. So the house is open. If you have any questions to any of the panelists. Yeah, and meanwhile, there is a very nice course which would be of interest to this audience, is about the rapid fire diagnostics for residents, and that's in Hall E immediately after this at 12 o'clock. Dr. Meenakshi has curated a very nice course with some superstar faculty members as part of the program. So any questions for the topics that we have covered so far?
Also,
Mike, there is a
In the meanwhile, while the mic is being organized, there is also a session on the same lines on a fellowship. It's called a fellowship help desk organized by the Young Ophthalmology Society of India. It's at 2 to 3, where Dr. Rashmin Gandhi and Dr. Meenakshi will also be there. And they're talking about how... And they'll be talking on how to... choose and decide your area of specialty and how to ace your fellowship interview and things to consider while you're planning a fellowship. So that will be at the Yo Pavilion today.
We had been discussing about examination like FRCS, which I feel is not only difficult but is expensive also.